So these are ideas about quantum mechanical view at the black hole dark matter with Cesar Gomez. There are all possible folk theorems about black holes. And these folk theorems tell us that black holes, they cannot carry, actually they are incompatible with global quantum numbers. So such as baryonic and leptonic numbers, and they cannot carry baryonic and leptonic charges. Now, this reasoning is based on an assumption, implicitly or explicitly, that black holes have no hair properties up to exponentially small corrections. Now, exponent is from n, which in semi-classical limit becomes entropy. So these corrections are, of course, negligible. Now, so one of the consequences of this folk theorems is that black holes, dark matter, primordial black holes with masses approximately 10 to the 16, 17 grams cannot exist because they operate too soon and so on. Now, so what I will do in this talk, I will argue that these folk theorems are violated by quantum mechanics. And the corrections to the black hole hair are 1 over n per quantum, which makes it extremely significant. So as a consequence of what I will say, one of the consequences would be that actually black hole dark matter with the masses much lower than what we thought could exist, stabilized by the baryonic charge. Okay. Now, at this point, you should stop me and say that I'm crazy, which may be independently true, but never mind about that. In this concrete case, let's discuss this case. Now, why? Why is this crazy? Why does this sound crazy? Because black holes are macroscopic. I'm talking about macroscopic black holes like galactic size or even bigger, solar mass black holes. And for those black holes, our normal intuition is that the macroscopic objects, they are classical with exponentially good accuracy. If I take an elephant, quantum gravity corrections to the elephant are suppressed by at least this exponent. They're actually, in reality, they're suppressed even more, but there is at least this exponent, mass times the size of the elephant. So, what is the miracle about the black hole? How come black holes are macroscopic, but quantum corrections are so important? In fact, if you compare elephant with the corresponding black hole of the same size or same mass or with any black hole, the quantum corrections that are exponentially small for an elephant are order one for a black hole, okay? Now, what is this miracle? What is happening? How this can be? Actually, it turns out that this, and this is my most important message of my talk, that if you don't take any other message, please take this, that what we are uncovering is that black holes are macroscopic but quantum, because they are systems which are at the critical point of quantum phase transition, okay? And they always stay at that critical point. And this is the extremely important fact about what I'm going to discuss. So this is a completely new type of object which is macroscopic and at the same time, in some respect, is extremely quantum, okay? Now, let me explain how can we understand these properties. Now, as you know, black holes have all possible mysteries. What I mentioned, absence of hair, exact thermality of Hawking radiation, Wittgenstein entropy, and so on. So this is a typical situation of a field theorist. This is Alice, who is puzzled by a black hole. So this is a black hole that evaporates. Alice is detecting radiation. In semi-classical limit, this radiation is thermal. In semi-classical limit, actually, it's exactly thermal. And Alice is trying to understand what is the source that is radiating this kind of spectrum. And in normal intuition is that if this must be some field theoretic substance in a thermal equilibrium at some temperature T, but none of them work, as we know, okay? Now, then, if you take this assumption of absence of hair and exact thermality, then there is a small logical gap which you have to fill with an assumption which turns out to be wrong. You arrive to all possible folk theorems which are absolutely fantastic because, for instance, absence of global charges, all of a sudden you take a galactic-sized black hole and this theorem tells you that it's completely incompatible with these global charges, global quantum numbers, information paradox, and so on, okay? Now, obviously, now to resolve this, what is going on, what is wrong with our assumptions, we need some microscopic picture. And let me try to provide one. And as we shall see, as a result of this microscopic picture, we'll see that actually black holes can carry baryonic and leptonic hair, which could be of 100% importance astrophysically. Now, in order to understand this, let's try to recall how we introduce black holes. Black holes we introduce through the metric. Now, metric is an intrinsically classical concept. The moment you define an entity which has a well-defined value at every given point, that's a classical notion. But our world is quantum mechanical. So if I'm a quantum field theorist, for me, there is a vacuum, the creation and annihilation operators, and particles, OK? So now you have Alice, and Alice is trying, is doing for the following experiment. So she's sitting there. She knows GR as a quantum theory of gravitons. And then she is doing experiment of forming a black hole of the galactic size, OK? Now, she knows that she can form this black hole out of gravitons of the wavelength of the galactic size. She doesn't need to cross anywhere near the Planck length, OK? So all the curvatures and all the invariants are ridiculously small. She can form this black hole. Now, at that point, you can ask this question. She's asking the following question. OK, there are two possibilities. One is that you say, OK, the moment this black hole got formed, this became something out of this world, no more describable in terms of gravitons. Okay? Now, if you make this assumption, then you don't have to listen to the rest of the talk, okay? Which is one possibility. You will be in the good company. That there are people that believe that, right? No, this should be taken seriously. I'm not proving that that's impossible. But there is another possibility that this black hole continues to be describable in terms of gravitons, of normal occupation number, some state of gravitons, okay? Let's follow that path. Now then, you are forced to say that metric is an emergent concept, okay? There is no more metric. Metric is a classical notion. What are you dealing with? You are dealing with some occupation number of gravitons with in some characteristic wavelength, some kind of Bose-Einstein condensate, but quantum. Now, of course, at this point, you can also tell me, I mean, what's the big deal? I can take a laser pulse, okay, and I can think of this laser pulse as a bunch of photons. That's also, I mean, quantum description. It turns out that there's a dramatic difference between the laser pulse and black holes, because laser pulse is not at the critical point of quantum phase transition. If you inject huge number of photons, laser pulse becomes more and more classical. Black holes do not. That's the point. Now, in order to understand this, let's recall what is Einstein gravity viewed as a quantum field theory, okay? Now, Einstein gravity viewed as a quantum field theory is a theory of particle with spin two and mass zero, which interacts quantum mechanically through this interaction strength, which you can define like this. This is h bar times g Newton times the de Broglie wavelength of the momentum transfer in graviton-graviton scattering. Now, then you can define in certain useful quantities. One is the Planck length, which is just h bar times Newton's constant. And in terms of Planck length, you can define alpha in this convenient way. So this is basically the ratio of the Planck length to the wavelength of the graviton squared. Now, as we see, in h bar going to zero limit, Planck scale becomes zero. So it's an intrinsically quantum concept. Okay? So does alpha. Now, I invite Alice to do the following experiment. Okay? So she's trying to form black hole or whatever state out of gravitons. Okay? She's trying to form a wave packet out of gravitons. Also, some characteristic wavelengths. Okay? Some lambda, the wavelength lambda, which is much longer than the Planck length, let's say galactic size. What is she doing? She is putting on top of each other as many gravitons as possible. Now, if you take two gravitons of 1 centimeter wavelength, alpha, their interaction constant, is 10 to the minus 66. That's almost a free theory. They don't see each other. So you have to put many before they start seeing each other. If you put many, then some critical phenomena happens. So typical Hartree situation, because each individual graviton starts to seeing a collective effect from the rest, okay? Now, what happens is that now you can do this completely straightforward analysis. You can say, okay, let me do some equation in which I require that the escape energy of a graviton is balanced by the attraction from the rest, okay? And you can rewrite this in a very simple form, which is very instructive, though. You discover that this graviton wave packet, let's call it wave packet, let's not call it a black hole, becomes self-sustained to the leading order in 1 over n when alpha between individual gravitons is 1 over n. Okay? So alpha n being 1 is some very important critical point. Now, so at this point, this self-sustained Bose condensate, it is a Bose condensate because you have a bunch of gravitons characteristic wavelength, is only characteristic by one quantity, n, because everything is balanced through n, okay? Now, the important property of this condensate, okay, this is the balance, is that it's leaky. Now, leaky condensates are known in condensed metaphysics. But here, the point is that this condensate is leaky all the time. Why? Because it's on the verge of keeping its gravitons. It continuously loses gravitons. Why? Because there are quantum fluctuations. They're always, even if you try to put gravitons in the ground state, there is no ground state because they rescatter virtually, and then one of them gains energy and leaves the condensate. Now, because the binding energy was again provided by gravitons, so you get like a bucket which leaks and decreases, so continuously leaks. Now, this leakage is what in the classical limit becomes Hawking radiation, okay? In the semi-classical limit. Now, you can compute this leakage in using Feynman diagrams in 1 over n expansion, and you get the following depletion law. So the leading diagram is when two gravitons rescatter, there is a momentum exchange, and then the depletion is self-similar. Now, the important thing is not the leading term, which simply reproduces Hawking's result in the semi-classical limit, but the correction, which goes like 1 over n. Now, what happens is that I can take limit now to make contact with. So far, I'm not saying that this is a black hole. You don't know what it is. This is some state formed out of gravitons, which has this fantastic property that it leaks, and it has negative heat capacity. Why? Because it leaks, and its wavelength shortens, and the number shortens. So if you take this limit in which you define formally T, you can call it, you don't have to call it temperature. You just define T parameter, and then take limit when n goes to infinity, L plan goes to 0, but this is fixed, you recover Stefan Boltzmann's law, okay? You just recover Hawking's result, period, okay? Now, this, what does this tell you? This tells you that if this object that I have just identified is really a black hole, then Alice was completely wrong in thinking that it's the substance that radiates is some substance in thermal equilibrium. There is nothing like thermal equilibrium. This is a cold Bose-Einstein condensate at the point of leakage. And the reason, if you compute time scales, it has absolutely no time to equilibrate and be in thermal equilibrium. It's a cold evaporation, okay? It's cold depletion. Now, the reason why you reproduce thermal spectrum, because they are very soft. You have a bunch of soft gravitons. Of course, what is thermal spectrum? Thermal spectrum is telling that to produce hard stuff is exponentially suppressed. Of course, if you have a bunch of soft stuff, to produce hard stuff out of it is exponentially suppressed by combinatorics, simply. Because in order to create graviton, which is much harder than the characteristic wavelength, you have to rescatter many. Every time you rescatter many, you are punished by gravity, by corrections. OK, so now what is the very important message? The important message is that the corrections are 1 over n and not exponent minus n. OK? This is absolutely important, because on the time scale and on the number of quanta, this correction is 100%. Now, again, now let's. At this point, you can again tell me that, okay, this is fine. This is one possible view. Let's say I convinced you. You don't have to be convinced. You can repeat the computation. But let's say I convinced you. They say, okay, the computations show this type of strange result. But how can it be? What is the physical meaning? How can this huge macroscopic object continuously stays at the critical point, okay? Alpha n equals 1. The point is this, okay? Let me give you some qualitative reasoning. Well, actually, this is not really qualitative. This is pretty good. The point is this. Let's consider other macroscopic objects, okay? For instance, bucket of water, all right? Now, for bucket of water, you can also tell me, why can't I apply your theory to bucket of water? Bucket of water has a bunch of molecules. I can also think about n and go on. The reason why you cannot apply, because bucket of water has no universal alpha. To define alpha, let's say molecule number 1 and 2 interact differently at number 1 and this guy, and so on. So alpha is a matrix. So you cannot define universal alpha for a bucket of water. Now, there are other substances for which you can define universal alpha. These substances are Bose-Einstein condensates. To define universal alpha, you need a situation when everybody talks to each other at equal strength. Okay? That's what is happening in Bose-Einstein condensates. So there you can define universal alpha, and therefore you can define alpha, this quantity alpha n. Now, it turns out that in most of the Bose-Einstein condensates, this quantity n alpha is not equal to 1. In most of the ordinary situations, it's very different from 1. It's either much less or much larger. It turns out that some miracle happens when n alpha is 1. At this point, you are the critical point of quantum phase transition. Okay? So in other words, no matter how big is your object, your quantum mechanics 100% matters. Why? Because, as usual, when phase transition happens, your system changes the regime. It is going from one state to the other. Okay? Now, let me not go into details what these are. But one of the signals is that, as you know, I mean, if I have a Bose-Einstein condensate, the excitations about the condensate are Bogoliubov modes, right? So typically, these Bogoliubov modes, they are tower, and they are irrelevant. So if I take this table, it has Bogoliubov modes, but they are completely useless. That's why they're exponentially suppressed. For black hole, because at n equals 1, it turns out all the Bogoliubov modes and Bogoliubov modes become gapless. So this is really an absolutely incredible phenomenon of nature. Never mind whether you believe that this is a black hole or not, because you have a macroscopic object, and the mass gap collapses to almost zero. It's 1 over n, OK? So you have a macroscopic object in which, at no expense almost, you can store exponential degeneracy. So this means that you can store a huge amount of information, OK? Now, this is why black holes, in this depletion process, they always stay at the critical point. Because you should not think that there is one black hole at the critical point. There are exponentially large number of states which are in critical point. And of course, system is always tries to track this point, because that's the most probable quantum mechanically. That is what's happening, OK? Now, as one of the consequences of this, of course, it's a trivial consequence that, of course, now there is not even a trace of this no hair, because there is an n baryon over n hair effect, quantum mechanically, if you have baryons and you throw them into a black hole. Now, what's the diagram that is responsible for this? So this is a diagram how, let's do the following experiment. We have a black hole, and we throw a baryon in, and Alice is trying to detect the baryon by measurement. So this is the diagram. In this example, I took baryon to be massless. I'm sorry about that. It's just a hypothetical baryon. So this massless baryon fluctuates virtually out of a black hole exactly through the same depletion diagram. This is Alice's device. And so she measures this hair with the rate, which is nb over n suppressed. OK? Oh, great. So this is the suppression rate of the hair. And now it's obvious that if I have one baryon and I have a solar mass black hole, this 1 over n is 10 to the minus 71. So there is a 10 to the minus 71 probability for me to detect a baryon if I throw it into a solar mass black hole, if it's only made out of gravitons. There is nothing unusual about that. Now, if I take semi-classical limit, of course I recover these no-hair theorems, because n goes to infinity, and the probability to detect it goes to zero. But this is an intrinsically quantum mechanical effect. And it's impossible to be captured in semi-classical analysis. No matter how many times you write down a metric, try to fluctuate around the metric, you will not recover this effect, because this effect is 1 over n correction to each order in RG over R in semi-classical computation. Okay? This is an intrinsically quantum effect. That's why Hawking cannot see it, and actually nobody that is doing semi-classical analysis can see this effect. Okay? Now, so then you can go on and ask this question, for instance, how much time does it take for me to recover this baryon as a result of evaporation? You can solve these equations. Let me not bother you with these completely straightforward technicalities. As a matter of time, you recover pages time automatically in this picture. Now, as long as now, let's ask this. Let's come back in this remaining 1 minute to dark matter, right? Because this is important. This is precisely the point why this is important for the black hole dark matter. Because if I have a primordial black hole which is made out of baryons. So at the beginning, usually what happens, because real baryons are massive, what happens is that at the beginning, occupation number of baryons is negligible compared to the occupation number of gravitons. Still, there are much more gravitons than normal baryons. Then, therefore, most of the time, black hole depletes by emitting gravitons until their numbers equilibrate. Okay? Now, once their numbers equilibrate, the story changes 100%. Now, what is this continuation of this result? We don't know, strictly speaking. We are now in the process of understanding it. One thing is clear, that the evolution of the black hole is nothing like what we thought was semi-classically. The corrections are 100% important now. They are very good arguments. Unfortunately, they are only arguments. I cannot prove it at the moment. But they are very good arguments that what happens is that after that, once NB is equal to N, the black hole gets stabilized by baryonic charge. Okay? And so essentially, you have black hole type object, okay, with NB equals to N. And essentially, they could be much smaller than the typical size that was normally semi-classically expected. Okay? And this is very interesting because so once black hole crosses over to in the through the QCD length, it seems that that is the case as long as NB is of order N. Again, I mean, I don't have a proof at the moment. They are just very strong indications that this is what is happening. Okay, but in any case, for sure, one thing is certain, that there will be some pockets of stability in this region. Okay. And so that's very interesting, because now you can have dark black hole dark matter of sort of different type of species, because you can have black hole smaller, larger, and so on, Planckian size. And obviously, this has implications the way we should think about dark matter. So therefore, here, as to conclude, here is Alice. And now she's probably happier. I don't know if she looks happier, but because now the final state of a black hole is not so black. I don't know. I tried to paint some red here. These are baryons. OK, let me finish with this. Thank you.